Welcome to church. Best day of the year, Easter Sunday morning. We're glad you're choosing to join with us for our service this morning. Normally on Easter, we have a little saying that we like to do. I'll say, "He is risen," and you will say, "He is risen indeed." So even though you're at home, I'll still say it, and you shout it at your TV or computer screen this morning. He is risen. Hey, great job. Could almost hear you from here. This morning, being it is Easter, we're going to do a few things different. We have a few extra video clips for you, a couple of praise and worship songs that you can sing along with as we prepare for this morning's message. So I pray that as you watch, as you enjoy, that you'll worship with us and that God will truly speak to your heart here today.
I believe in the sun. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. Covered in sin and shame, I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the sun away. Amen. Amen. I'm alive. I'm alive because he lives.
About the Easter story.
Jesus was born, and then he grew older, and all of a sudden he got popular, and all these people meant to see him, and God healed some, he made good miracles, and Jesus became to be popular, and the kings did not like that. So they locked him up, and they beat him up and put a throne on him, like a thorny throne,
like a crown.
Yeah, and they put him on a cross. They nailed his hands and his feet on the cross, And he went to a tomb, and this huge stone was rolled onto his thing, and like about everybody had to do it.
So, Eva. And then, so Mary brought two friends, and there's an angel that rolled away the stone before that, and then they came. And 3 days later, then the angel came. Then he rolled away the stone, and then the Mary and two friends came, and the angel said, "Do not be afraid," and he is not dead.
And they were like, "That's a miracle." And they Mary looked in the tomb, he was not there. And then almost 500 people saw him after he rose again. And it's the end of the story.
And they all had joy. They were all happy.
He is risen. Three small words that brought the collective pace of humanity to an absolute standstill. He is risen. Three words that shattered prisons. Words that shook the earth's foundations. Words that transformed a sense of utter despair into cries of pure joy and ecstasy. Echoes of history's greatest triumph that still shape our reality. Even today, we're assaulted by constant distraction, countless sources waging war for our attention, yet three words pierce the noise. In our hunger for validation, our desperate pleas for love and attention, three words calm our anxieties. In a universe spinning at breakneck speed, its inhabitants locked in an existential crisis, three words proclaim the purpose of our existence. He is risen. Lay hold of this truth and embrace the peace within. Yesterday, fear reigned in our hearts. Yesterday, we sat in crippling darkness. Yesterday, we suffered abuse and all the accusations of a broken world. But today, our King, our healer, our defender is risen. And this reality doesn't merely accompany us on a meaningless journey. This changes everything. For you see, if he is risen, then all other pursuits become secondary. All of our failures become insignificant. All criticisms and condemnations become irrelevant. There is only his word, his mission, and his infinite, unconditional love for you. Because he is risen, we look to tomorrow. Tomorrow we will stop defining our worth through status and social media. Tomorrow we will together build an everlasting kingdom. Tomorrow and every day after, we will dance in the radiance of a redeeming Savior who crushed death and set us free. There is nothing that Jesus cannot overcome. We know this because he lives. We know this because he is risen.
Have you ever said something that you wish you could take back? Chances are we've all been there, whether it was an unkind word, a dare we too easily accepted, or a promise that we couldn't keep. This morning, we're going to look at one of Jesus' disciples who said something that he wished he could take back and how that moment drastically altered the course of his life. But we're going to do it a little bit differently today. We're going to step back in time and hear from his own lips how this encounter with Jesus changed everything. If you're watching with your family or someone else, I encourage you to take your Bibles and turn to John chapter 20, verses 24 through 31. We'll read this account first, before we hear from Thomas how this encounter with the risen Jesus changed everything. John chapter 20, verses 24 through 31. Well, hello everyone. My name is Thomas. Sometimes you may hear me called Didymus, which actually means twin. Apparently, Pastor Andy and I today are twinning, but you can just call me Thomas for the time being. Pastor Andy asked me to come here today to share with you an encounter that I had with the risen Jesus. There's really only one encounter that comes to mind this risen morn. It's the encounter that everyone remembers me for, and the encounter where I got my nickname, Doubting Thomas. I mean, don't you hate just being labeled? It's as if, for some people, that label is what defines you. But hopefully, as you'll see throughout our time here together, that this label doesn't accurately define me. There's so much more to the story. So let's dive in and see how this encounter with Jesus changed everything for me. I remember the encounter just like it was yesterday. It was shortly after Jesus had risen from the dead. The other disciples, my friends, came running up to me all out of breath, and they were excited. They said, "We have seen the Lord." Now, it's important to note that I wasn't with the disciples after Jesus was crucified. Do you know why I wasn't there? Take a moment and discuss with the people around you. See, a lot of people think that I was afraid, that I was too scared of the religious leaders. See, the religious leaders, we thought, kind of wanted to kill us too. They were doing everything they could to get rid of every single memory of Jesus, and so naturally, we were next in line to be killed. But can I be honest with you? I really wasn't that scared. I mean, sure, I was a little bit scared, but that wasn't really the main reason why I was with the disciples. You see, I'm not one to run away from danger, although I did kind of run away from Jesus the night he was arrested. But do you remember what my buddy John said, John chapter 11? Pastor Andy told me you talked about this encounter with Jesus a few weeks ago. Lazarus is sick, and Jesus says this sickness will not end in death, that everything is going to be okay. But then all of a sudden, Jesus changes his mind 2 days later, and now he wants to go and visit Jesus, visit Lazarus. The only problem is, when Jesus was there before, the Jews had tried to kill him. They had tried to stone him. And so naturally, we didn't think it was the best idea for us to go and see Lazarus at this time. But Jesus insists, and so finally I spoke up and said, "Hey, let us also go that we may die with him." Listen, I wasn't afraid to die. If I had a sword, I would have raised it confidently up in the air at that moment. But Peter was the guy who always got to carry the sword, even though he didn't know how to use it. I mean, best he could do was cut off a guy's ear. Ha! But anyway, I wasn't afraid of death. So why wasn't I there, you wonder? Well, I guess I would explain it this way, that I really loved Jesus. I was willing at one point to die for him. And then I ran away just like everyone else. I was embarrassed, a little bit ashamed, and honestly just overcome with grief. I mean, my Lord and my God was dead. I just needed some time to get away and to process all this. The other disciples, all they wanted to do was hang out together and keep talking about it, but I just needed some time and some space. That's the way I worked through my grief. But anyway, back to this encounter. And so my friends all tell me that when I do meet up with them, that they had seen the risen Jesus. Now let me ask you this. What would your response be to your friends in that moment? If you had seen your best friend killed, wouldn't you be a little hesitant to believe them also? I mean, that's the way I was. I simply couldn't believe it. I mean, think about it. You got Peter telling me that he saw Jesus. This guy denied Jesus 3 times publicly. He would do anything for a shot at a chance of redemption. And then there's John. He's the baby of the group, right? He really loved Jesus. He even referred to himself as the one whom Jesus loved, right? He's willing to believe anything for the chance just to be with Jesus again. So can you really blame me for not believing them initially? Listen, it's not that I didn't want to believe them. I really did. But the fact of the matter is that I had just worked through my grief. I had just processed all that happened. I'd come to grips with the reality of what had just transpired, and now they're telling me that Jesus is alive again. You see, friends, the reality is that more than anything, I wanted to be with Jesus. Again, if you remember the words of John in John chapter 14, Jesus is telling us he's got to go. And he's telling us about this place that he's going to prepare for us. And it sounds great. It sounds wonderful. And then he said this, "And you know the place where I am going." Now, I was a little bit confused. I mean, I didn't know if he was talking about Jerusalem or a new vacation home he was building in the Far East. I didn't know what Jesus was talking about. And so I asked Jesus a simple question. I said, "Lord, listen, we don't know the way. We don't know where you're going. Can you tell us?" You see, I just wanted to be with Jesus. And I loved him. I didn't want to leave him. I wanted to stay with him forever. And Jesus went on to tell us how we could do that. He said in John 14, verse 6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me." I just didn't understand it at the time. And I didn't understand it when my friends were coming to me telling me that Jesus was alive. But let's be honest. They weren't so quick to believe the news that Jesus was alive either. I mean, if you remember in Luke chapter 24, verses 9 through 11, Luke said, "When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense." And then earlier, Jesus has appeared to his disciples, and what does he have to do for them? He shows them his hands, the nail holes that are there. He showed them his side. So cut me a little slack for not believing my friends at first. Now, can I be honest with you again? The reason it was so hard for me to believe was that I simply didn't want to be disappointed again. I had come to grips with Jesus' death. I knew that things were never going to be the same again. I was ready to move on. I didn't want to get my hopes up only to have them come crashing down again. I just didn't think I could go through that kind of pain again. Some of you watching may be feeling that exact same thing this morning, that you're disappointed. Your journey with Jesus may have started out great, but then some crazy things happened. The coronavirus hit. Maybe you had a bad church experience. Maybe you're struggling in your marriage or with your kids. Maybe your finances aren't all that they were cracked up to be. You had a good run, but now fear and worry and disappointment have set in, and you're not ready to believe again. This is just going to be the way life is from now on, you reason. But take it firsthand from me, good old doubting Thomas. Jesus is alive. And when you truly encounter the risen Christ, your life will never be the same. That doesn't mean that your situations and circumstances will change. In fact, they may never change. They may even get harder than you anticipated. But don't ever lose hope. Don't ever come to grips with what your reality is in such a way that you stop believing in the God who has the power to shape and change your reality in the blink of an eye. I stopped believing for a few minutes. I came to grips with what I thought was reality. I was ready to go on my own. I was so set in my ways that I boldly and defiantly exclaimed, "Unless I see the nail marks in the hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand in his side, I will not believe." What a fool I was. I wish I could take those words back, but I can't. The only thing I can do is change the way that I live. And I've done that. Will you? Will you give Jesus another shot? Will you give his people, his bride, his church, another chance? Well, after I said these words, not much changed that first week. Life seemed to go on as normal. It seemed like I was right, and maybe my friends were wrong. But everything was about to change. We're in the same house, in the same room where Jesus appeared to the other disciples. This time, I was with them. And just like last time, we had the door locked. And here comes Jesus. I mean, I don't know where he came from. One minute he's there, the next minute he's not. But he's there. He didn't come in the door or the window. He just appeared. And what does he say? He says, "Peace be with you." See, this was the exact same thing he said to the disciples when he visited them before. It's almost like he was trying to convince the other disciples that what they had experienced last week really had happened. Maybe some of my friends were starting to doubt too. But after Jesus said that, he ignored the rest of the disciples, and he walked up to me, and he looked right at me. I would have expected anger, perhaps maybe even a bit of a cocky attitude. After all, I had been a jerk. I mean, Jesus was right. He's alive.
And yet I had refused to believe. And yet Jesus looked at me the exact same way he always did, with love and compassion in his eyes. Well, you know what happens next? Jesus addressed my doubt. He put out his hands and he told me to put my finger in the nail holes. He told me to go ahead and put my hand in his side. And then he told me this. He said, stop doubting and believe. See, friends, I believe if Jesus were here today, he would tell some of you the exact same thing. He would address your doubt and he would say to you, stop doubting and believe. I mean, you have all the evidence. We have his word. We have the testimony of the disciples. We have those who have believed and who've been so powerfully changed as proof that Jesus is alive. Stop doubting and believe. Well, what was my response to all this? I didn't really need to put my finger in the nail holes or my hand in his side. When I saw Jesus, I simply believed. And I fell to my face and I cried out, my Lord and my God. I admitted that he was truly God and I was submitting my life to him. What other response could one possibly have in that moment? If Jesus rose from the dead, then every single thing he said is true. He is who he said he is, that he is the Son of God, that he is God in the flesh. There's nothing greater. There's no other acceptable response to have to the risen Jesus than this, than to bow down and to call him my Lord and my God. Well, there you have it, from the lips of one of Jesus' own disciples, from the pages of Scripture. Did Thomas truly change after this? Did this encounter with the risen Jesus really change his life that drastically? Well, listen to these words from John MacArthur in his book, 12 Ordinary Men. Ancient history records that Thomas took the gospel all the way to India. Even today, there is a marker where Thomas is said to have been buried. There are churches that are traceable all the way back to the beginning of the church age, and tradition says they were founded under Thomas's ministry. The strongest traditions say that he was martyred for his faith by being run through with a spear, a fitting form of martyrdom for one whose faith came to fruition when he saw the spear mark in his master's side, end quote. I'd say Thomas truly believed, and this encounter with the risen Jesus truly changed his life. John adds two more verses in this account after this encounter with Jesus. These are often thought of as the theme verses of his gospel, and he writes in John 20, verses 30 and 31, Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. That is the purpose for which John records everything we've been talking about these last several weeks. First of all, they are written that you may believe. Notice that John didn't say they are written that you might believe a certain set of facts or so that you may have a sound theology. He said these things are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Son of God. It's belief in a person, not a set of facts. And then John says these are written ultimately so that you may have life. After all, this is why Jesus came. Jesus himself said in John 10:10, I have come that you might have life, and that you might have it more abundantly. Listen, people who don't have belief don't have life. It's as simple as that. In order to have the life that God created us to have, we must find it in the Son of God. And Jesus told us how to find it. He said again in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father. No man has this life except through me. No man can experience true life apart from Jesus. Well, by way of application, let me ask you a couple questions here this morning. First of all, what are your reasons for not believing in Jesus? Listen, they may sound like valid reasons, but in the end, they will not lead to life. Will you believe the evidence that you've been given in the Word of God? See, friends, the Bible tells us that God created us to have a relationship with Him. That God spoke all the world into existence, but on day six, God came down to this earth he created, and he stooped down in the mud, and he created the image of a man, and he breathed into that man's nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. And God didn't just make us like one of the animals. No, God created us in his very image. the ability to represent and to reflect who God is to the rest of creation, the chance to know good from evil. And God, as he created Adam and Eve, could have left them alone, but he chose to walk and talk with Adam and Eve. He chose to have that good and perfect relationship with them. And like any relationship, this relationship with God had a rule, one rule to be exact. And that rule was this, that you can eat from any tree that's in the garden. You can enjoy everything that God's created except the tree that's in the middle of the garden. Because on the day that you eat of that tree, you will surely die. And one day as Adam and Eve were out walking in the garden, they came near that tree and they heard a voice that they didn't know, a voice that they didn't recognize. And as they drew near to that tree, the voice began to cause them to doubt and to question God. Did God really say this? Does God really love you? Because after all, if God really loved you, he'd let you do whatever you wanted. You can eat from this tree. It's okay. In fact, if you eat from this tree, God knows that you're going to be just like him. Now, the reality is Adam and Eve were already just like him. You and I, created in God's image, are already just like him. But Adam and Eve chose to believe the lie. And in that moment, they ate. And at that moment, sin and death entered into the world. And if we were to die in our trespasses and sins, God's word tells us that we would spend eternity in hell, separated from him forever. That's what our sin, that's what our rebellion against God deserves. But God, because he loved us, God, because he still wanted to have a relationship with us, sent his son Jesus to come to this earth to live a sinless life, to show us exactly who the Father is and what he expected. And then he went to the cross and he took upon himself your sin and my sin. He bore the penalty. He died the death that we deserved. He took on God's wrath in his body so that we could have life. And then to show that God accepted his sacrifice, 3 days later, he raised Jesus from the dead. He raised him to new life. And we have eyewitness testimony from Thomas, from the other disciples, from the women, from 500 plus people who saw Jesus after he was raised from the dead. Jesus really is alive. And because Jesus is alive, we know that everyone who puts their faith and trust in Jesus alone can and will have eternal life, just like Jesus said. And that life with Jesus, it starts now and it lasts forever. Friends, will you believe the evidence? Will you today put your faith and trust in the risen Jesus? Secondly, I would challenge you this way. Maybe you're watching and you become disillusioned with church and with Christianity. I'll be honest, sometimes Christians will let you down. Sometimes the church will let you down, but that is never a good reason to give up on Jesus. Will you open your heart again this Easter to the message of Christ? Will you allow this encounter with the risen Jesus that you've experienced here today change your life forever? Well, let me sum up what we've talked about this morning by giving you a bottom line. And that bottom line is simply this. The words spoken to Thomas by the disciples are the same words that have been spoken to us today. Jesus is alive. We have seen the Lord. Like Thomas, will you confess Jesus as my Lord and my God?
Crowned with glory now, the Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at his feet we bow.
his body.